Good day. This is a case report entitled Seeing with Sound, Subglottic Tracheal Stenosis Diagnosed by Emergency Department Point of Care Ultrasound. Assessment of a difficult airway is a challenge that every emergency medicine specialist faces on a daily basis. History taking is not always contributory with physical examination. This is why emergency physicians are restricted only to what one can visualize or hear. Several tools available in the emergency department, such as direct laryngoscopy, which would offer visualization of the airway that is often limited to the glottic region. Any constriction or obstruction below the glottis presents a challenge in selecting the safest imaging modality with the least risk to the patient. Subglottic airway impairments, such as tracheal stenosis, are life-threatening conditions. This requires quick diagnosis and intervention by an EM physician. If left unaddressed in a patient with dyspnea, tracheal stenosis may lead to a respiratory failure and cardiac arrest secondary to hypoxia. There are some challenges involved. These are limited modalities available to diagnose such cases with only CT scan and MRI, and even the transfer required to the radiology department, which adds additional risk for the patient being far from the emergency department. Point-of-care ultrasound in the evaluation of airway can measure tracheal diameter, identify the cricothyroid membrane to facilitate a surgical airway, and confirm ET tube placement. The use of point-of-care ultrasound has been comparable to an MRI in measuring the trachea. However, to date, there is limited utility or protocolization of POCUS in diagnosing lower airway defects. This case report demonstrates utility of POCUS in a patient who was diagnosed with subglottic tracheal stenosis via airway sonography. This is a case of CB, a 58-year-old male, Roman Catholic, coming in for progressive difficulty of breathing. He is hypertensive, diabetic, and dyslipidemic, no history of cancer, allergy, and blood dyscrasia, 42-pack-year smoker and an alcoholic drinker. 5 weeks prior to consult, patient was admitted to a different institution after going into cardiac arrest secondary to myocardial infarction. Patient was given cardiopulmonary resuscitation upon arrival at the emergency room. Return of spontaneous circulation was achieved after 45 minutes of CPR with a total of 11 doses of epinephrine. Patient was intubated and admitted to the ICU for 7 days. He was discharged stable, with a cerebral performance category score of 5 and advised work up of 2D echo on an outpatient basis. 3 weeks prior to consultation, patient experienced intermittent left-sided chest pain of 5 out of 10 intensity. There was no associated dyspnea, orthopnea, or diaphoresis. He consulted at SLMCQC emergency department and work up revealed normal ECG finding and negative cardiac enzymes. He was eventually diagnosed with costochondritis and prescribed with isosorbide dinitrate for onset of chest pain or heaviness associated with dyspnea and diaphoresis. There were no further episodes of chest pain. 2 days prior to consultation, patient had sudden onset of difficulty of breathing described as air hunger, aggravated by exertion and associated with coughing, hoarseness, sternal chest pain, and audible wheezing. The difficulty of breathing increased in severity for the next 48 hours, prompting consultation at SLMCQC. Physical examination showed BP of 170 over 100, heart rate of 97, RR of 24, O2 sat of 100%, and temperature of 37.1. Patient was conscious, coherent, with no neck vein distension, with noted stridor on auscultation, a dynamic precordium, with normal rate regular rhythm, symmetric chest expansion with the use of accessory muscles, with the adventitious sounds echoing from the upper airway and crackles and wheezes on both bases of the lungs. ED workup was done, showing ECG of sinus rhythm with complete right bundle branch block, ABG showing compensated metabolic alkalosis, a chest x-ray showing clear lungs, and a cervical x-ray showing no gross obstruction of airway or signs of swelling. Rigid endoscopy was further done, showing good vocal fold movements, adequate glottic opening, no mass or obstruction seen, no laryngeal edema or hyperemic structure. POCUS of the airway was subsequently done, a linear probe placed on the suprasternal notch, then fanned caudally. Presence of concentric echogenicity along the trachea, with the predominant ring-down artifact was visualized inferior to this concentric echogenicity. This was the focus of our patient, seen on the right. This is the trachea, which showed concentric hypoechogenicity with the hyperechoic borders, the yellow arrow, showing stenosed segment of trachea and the ring-down artifact inferior to it. Confirmatory imaging was subsequently done. CT scan showed concentric narrowing of the subglottic trachea at the retrosternal region, measuring approximately 1.7 cm in its craniocaudal length. There was also note of soft tissue fullness at the left posterior lateral wall with no definite fat plane between the tracheal wall and esophagus. Esophagogram was normal. Patient transferred to another institution where rigid bronchoscopy with tracheal stenting was done, which eventually improved the patient's condition. For our discussion, upper airway obstruction diagnosis is essentially by a history and physical examination. Some diagnostics can be done, such as plain X-ray, rigid endoscopy, CT scan, or MRI. The best imaging tool to date is computed tomography with 2D planar or curve reconstruction and 3D imaging that includes volume rendering functions. Tracheal stenosis is a serious condition, which may present in a patient with dyspnea and stridor. Symptomatic dyspnea is usually evident in adults with tracheal diameters measuring 8 mm or less, and a resting dyspnea occurs when the airway diameter is less than 5 mm. Tracheal stenosis induced by endoscopic or endotracheal intubation is due to the transient irritation brought about by the ET tube in the airway, which causes significant edema and pressure on the tracheal mucosal surface. The pressure causes ulceration of the tracheal mucosa, which by healing brings about fibrosis and eventually causes stenosis of the tracheal lumen. Ultrasound is not commonly used as a primary tool in diagnosing tracheal lesion. Sonographic evaluation of the airway relies much on detecting the presence of a normal ultrasound artifact, such as reverberation artifact. To date, this case report represents the first documentation of the ultrasound artifacts of tracheal stenosis that correlated well with CT finding of the neck. It presents a potential sonographic finding that may be used to diagnose patients with suspected subglottic tracheal stenosis. This case report further adds validation to the versatile utility of point-of-care ultrasound in evaluating and managing patients in the emergency department. This case report demonstrates the potential utility of point-of-care ultrasound as a non-invasive and bedside tool in diagnosing patients with suspected subglottic tracheal stenosis in the setting of equivocal X-ray and endoscopic finding.